in there, because it could all be an energy group. Because the city of Antioch, they partnered with Paul, gathered there in the city, and they remained, there for a year. And they talked to people there in Antioch, all along the church, and all around the city. And actually, it was in the city of Antioch that the Christians were first called Christians. And they, since that time to this day, were now known as Christians. So it's an important little piece of information for you to keep in mind, that the first Christians were called Christians in the city of Antioch. And this was in the very early, just the first few years, when the apostles were preaching throughout the whole world. And what is it they were preaching? They were preaching here that God is the Trinity. Three persons in one God. The God is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And that Jesus Christ is God-man, God incarnate. He's one person with two natures and two wills. And he has risen from the dead. And that truth has been preached to today, even this moment. Because nothing has changed in the church. This is that truth that you and I all are to expose ourselves to come to believe and to follow. That means for us of all ages to come to grasp this very truth. And in today's gospel, we see here how once again this truth is being revealed to a woman of Samaria. Her name is spoken to me. Our Savior, Jesus Christ, God, was going from Judea to Galilee, and he was in Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary from the journey, sat thus on the well. It was about the sixth hour. What do we have here? A picture that's brought forth to us. What we see here is a man, Jesus Christ, who's weary, he's tired, he's been walking. And he sits down on the well. And this is in Samaria. Remember here that Christ told his disciples, do not go into any city of Samaria. And yet, when the Samaritan woman here comes to the well, Christ speaks with her. And he said, give me the drink. And the woman of Samaria, she said to Christ, how is it that thou, being a Jew, hast drink of me, whom a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with Samaria. The Jews did nothing, they had no dealings whatsoever with the Samaritans, because they had fallen away from the true worship of God. They still considered themselves Jews, but the Jews did not consider themselves Jews. And so they were ostracized, they were pushed aside, they were shunted. But you see, Christ said to his disciples, don't go into the city, any city of Samaria. But he didn't say to them, if a Samaritan comes to you and speaks to you, don't speak to him. Remember the leper, the 10 lepers? One of them was a Samaritan, the one who turned back and worshiped the true God. And here the Samaritan woman comes and speaks to him. And she's saying, you're not supposed to be talking to me, you're a Jew. And Jesus said to her, if thou knew the gift of God, and who it is that says to thee, give me to drink, you would have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. Now she doesn't, what she sees sitting in front of her is a man, tired, weary, perspiring, it's the sixth hour of the day, it's hot. She sees a man. She sees Christ in his humanity. But she doesn't see that it is God who's sitting on the well of Jacob's womb. It's God, Jesus Christ, God, man. And look how gently and with such love and compassion he begins to lead her to understand whom she is speaking. He said to her, you know, I could give you living water. Well, she's thinking about, wow, this is great. I got living water and I don't have to worry about coming and getting this water from the well there. She's still thinking about the earthly things. Actually, just as an aside, how many of us, that's what happens to us. All we think about is the worldly things, the material things, the things of today. How are we going to buy a new dress? Mommy, the girl asked, I need to have my dress. We're going to go. All the other girls in school wear certain clothes, and I have to wear them. The same thing with the boys. Oh, we're all concerned about the material possessions of the world. What are we going to do about tomorrow? And Christ is showing us by his example. First of all, he walked everywhere. He didn't go by girl. He walked. He's showing, don't be concerned about all these other things in this world. It's a hard lesson for us to come to grasp what Christ is asking us to do. So she's still thinking, well, what's this man talking about living with? And she asked Christ, are you greater than our father Jacob, which gave us this wealth and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? And Jesus said to her, whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst unto eternity. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into life everlasting. She's still thinking about the earthly things. She doesn't understand. And most of us don't understand that Christ isn't talking about the water that we get from the faucet. He's talking about the gift of the Holy Spirit. He's talking about spiritual things. She's still tied down. She's still speaking. And she's asking, and he's genuinely leading her. She's asking him, well, can I have this water? He said, give me this water, that I thirst not, and I don't have to come here to draw. What a wonderful opportunity. He's giving me everlasting water. Just think, I don't have to come to the well. I don't have to drop a bucket down and pull up the water. This man is offering me something that, for me, in this world, is going to be a nice way of life. She still hasn't grasped what he's saying. How many of us have totally grasped that truth that is being revealed to us, that this man, Jesus Christ, is God himself, the creator of the world, who is like my man. But now look what happened. She's talking about water. He's talking about water. She's thinking about water. Now he changes the conversation. Just turns it around. And he says to her, go, call thy husband, and come here. Uh-oh. She's in trouble. She says to Christ, I have no husband. I have no husband. Now listen to what Christ says. You have well said, I have no husband. Jesus said, you've had five husbands, and the man that you're now with is not your husband. This you have truly said. She's just been caught in sin. She's just been told how she's living because she was trying to hide it. And Christ reveals to her, look how kind, how gentle. He doesn't condemn her. He doesn't throw her over. But he says, look what you're doing. Look how you're living. And look at her response. She's caught. It's like if you and I, when we go to confessions, was in clairvoyant, and you would go to confession, and you wouldn't say a word, they just look at you and read your heart. And they start listing all the sins that you have. How would this would not have walked our feet? How would we so, what would we say? And yet, this is precisely because God reads the hearts of people. And so he revealed to her her own sinful way of life. And instead of fear, her saying, what are you talking about? How do you know how I live? She said, with that, she said, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Yes, the prophet, more than a prophet. He's the living God and has become man. She doesn't defend herself. She doesn't deny anything that she said. She says, I'm guilty. But at the same time, within herself, there's joy and there's fear. All this time, she's been living with her sins. She has had no way to relieve herself of her sins. And now she sees the man, Christ, that maybe now she has a chance to repent. Maybe now she has an opportunity to change herself. Because she's slowly being raised to understand that this is not just the prophet who's before her. What would you and I do if we would be standing at the well of Samaria, which we are right now? We transcend time and space, and there we are, seated with Christ at the well. And he looks at us, and he starts going name by name, and showing to us our sins. Well, you like the Samaritan woman? So, maybe you're right. And Christ said to her, God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman said unto him, I know that that Messiah comes, which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. You see, even though they only used the first five books of the Old Testament, they knew enough that the Messiah was coming. Now listen to what Christ says to you. I that speak unto thee am he. How much clearer need it be said? I am the Messiah. I am he who has been foretold of all in the Old Testament. All the prophets who have spoken of me. Now you see me in the flesh. There's no question that he is God himself who has become man. Now we see a woman, a simple woman, a Samaritan woman, who is transformed, who's turned around, because shall she believe? She believes that he is the Christ. He is the Messiah. He is God who has become man. And what did she do? She wasn't filled with shame. She wasn't embarrassed. She ran right back into the city. And she said to all the men, all the people she came in contact with, come on, see a man who told me all things that ever I did. May I be the Christ. And then all the people went out of the city because of her witness. And there they began to speak to Christ. And they said, now we believe, not because of your sin, for we have heard him ourselves and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. Look what's being revealed here, the fullness of the truth, that all that has been foretold has now come to pass. That truly here, God has entered time and space from time. Here, faithful to me, the Samaritan woman shows all of us how we see first the earth and good things. We see all that surrounds us because we want security. We need this, we need that. And yet she's been lifted up to understand that it's the spiritual things that are wanted for her. all these other things are passing in this life. Because she said she was told that a well of water springing up to everlasting life will spring forth to each of us. And that water springing up to everlasting life is the Holy Spirit. That water springing up to life, the everlasting life, is what you and I partake of at every divine liturgy. Because it's the body and blood of Christ, it's Holy Communion. That's why we gather here. To come and partake, to be fed, to drink of that life-giving spring. For it's Christ who dwells in us, who sanctifies us, who gives us the strength and the capabilities to live our lives each and every day. But you see, one critical aspect in all this, she repented. When her sins were brought before her face, she repented, she changed, and she followed Christ. I want to bring to your mind from the Old Testament. Remember the book of Jonah? I hope some of you have read the book of Jonah, 34 chapters, I'm very sure. If you haven't, go home and read. The story of Jonah, remember? God told Jonah, he had to go to the city of Nineveh because the city was so sinful and so bad, he was going to destroy it. And of course, Jonah didn't want to go, so he got on a ship and fled. And the storm came, and eventually things got so bad, they took Jonah and they threw him overboard. As soon as they threw him overboard into the ocean, the waves ceased. And a great whale came up and swallowed him. And for 3 days and 3 nights, he was in the belly of a whale. And the whale took him to Nineveh and spit him out. And then he walked through the city of Nineveh. And he began to tell them, citizens of Nineveh, 3 days more, and Nineveh will be overthrown. Now, can you imagine for somebody to come through and begin to preach to you, just like Isaiah the prophet did in Jerusalem? Eventually, he was taken out and sawn in half by the Jews because they didn't like what he was saying. But a whole city being told, you have 3 days and it's all over. And you notice God didn't say, if you repent, I'll do something. He just said, you have 3 days. And what did the people of Nineveh do? From the king of God, the king issued an order. Everybody fast for 3 days. No food, no water, no drink. Men, women, children, animals, nobody eats or drinks for 3 days. Can you imagine the screams, the cries, babies crying, cows mooing, calves mooing, all this tumult because they were fasting for 3 days. And God relented and forgave the Ninevites. You see, the Ninevites, after having been told their sinful change, they repent. Just like the Samaritan woman told you. And what does that show to us? It shows to us that we should never become discouraged. Can you imagine being told, we only got 3 days and it's all over? They didn't get discouraged. They decided we're going to struggle, we're going to fast, we're going to pray for God. And God forgave them. They never lost hope, and because of that, they overcame the devil. Because the devil's greatest weapon, as St. John Chrysostom says, is discouragement. We do not give, as St. John says, we do not give the devil as much pleasure when we sin as when we become discouraged and take his hopes. You see, we should never fall into despair. We should never think it's ever hopeless. Because the God we worship is a merciful, long-suffering, and forgiving God. And just as the Samaritan woman who had her sins open to Christ, So we ourselves, if we open our hearts to our Savior and begin to confess the things that we do wrong, to begin to understand, even though I repeat them over and over and over again, that the hope we have is that with God's help and grace, I'll overcome my sins and I'll come to follow my Savior. We see what happened to the Samaritan woman. After her sins were revealed to her, she went out and began to preach the good news. She couldn't help herself. She had to tell everybody. Well, likewise here for ourselves. We will see that if we truly learn to open ourselves up to the love of God and to confess our sin, then we too will be able, we'll have such joy. We won't be able to contain ourselves. We'll have to go out and begin to start to preach Christ. We're not preach Christ, this is our word. Not just by going out and standing on the corners and passing out pamphlets, this type of thing. No, begin to preach Christ by the way we live. This is what Orthodox way of life is all about. We're different if we follow Christ from what the world gives us as a way of life. And here, we'll see if we begin to live according to what Christ is teaching us. The people around us will respond. They too will say, now we believe. We believe here, not because of what you're saying, but we see how you live your life. What happens if we begin to see, instead of us being selfish and jealous and not sharing the things that we have, being cold-hearted, being unmerciful, but to begin to see us being compassionate and loving and giving, being willing to accept mockery and scorn rather than to deny the true God, they too will begin to see something different. And they too will see peace, joy, love, something that the world is seeking all in the wrong places. And here too for ourselves, we too will know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. That's what we have received here in the church. May we take it, may we grow, may that living water pour forth, which is the Spirit of God.